Hey everyone, it's Ben Hardy here, and yes, we're going to be going over the Raptor in today's video, but today's video is going to be a little bit different because obviously, well, we're in the driveway and I'm wearing shorts and turtle flip-flops, which I can't normally do that with reviews because if I walked into a dealership with this, then, well, they'd probably like instantly kick me out. So this video, just to like set your expectations, is I am going to be going over some of the features on the Raptor, but more importantly, I'm going to give my 2 cents on features that you should get or you should not get if you are planning on getting a Raptor. And then also I'm going to kind of go over to some like reliability things that I've heard from owners and all that kind of stuff, and hopefully that like sets the proper expectation for today's video, but let's just get into it. Now, most of you are familiar with the powertrain on the second generation Raptor. You have a twin turbo V6. It goes through a 10-speed automatic transmission with the power outputs of 450 horsepower and then 510 pound-feet of torque. 0-60 time of right around 5 seconds, and then fuel economy being 15 around town and 18 on the highway, which is a lie, by the way, because I only get like 12 miles per gallon. And yes, I know I need to clean this, but I'm not going to, but I got the interior cleaned and I cleaned the exterior by myself, so at least that looks good. It's just that doesn't look good. So yeah. Now the next thing to touch on with the engine bay is going to be modifications and then also reliability. So in terms of modifications, most people basically will just do tunes on this, cold air intake, all the regular stuff you're going to do to a car that has a turbocharged engine to get a little bit more power and performance, and then also get a little bit more sound out of the turbos as well. Now in terms of reliability, I have heard some issues with the first iterations of the second generation Raptors, so like the 17s and some stuff with the 18s. Now the powertrain up to the 19s and the 20s seems like it's a little bit better. They kind of have fixed a lot of the kinks, but there is still potential once you get to higher miles, and it won't be as reliable as the 6.2, so just take that into account. I think I picked like the perfect time of day for this video just because you can actually see the lights, and that's what I want to talk about with the front end. So the lights obviously look cool with the marker lights and all that, but the headlights themselves, they aren't the brightest at night, something that I've been disappointed about with the Raptor. My 2019 Rebel that I had, the lights at night were super bright. This isn't nearly as bright, so definitely a downside, and so it kind of makes me want to get like a light bar there and something up top and all that kind of stuff, just so I have a little bit better visibility. The other thing I want to mention is obviously something you can see for the front, which is the width. Now everyone says, oh, the Raptor's super wide, it's really hard to drive. It's actually not too bad. So again, my 2019 Rebel was only about 4 inches narrower than the Raptor. So, I mean, 4 inches sounds like a lot, but it's really not. And so this truck looks really wide, but you gotta remember, Fords are narrow. And so even though this is a wide body Ford, it's not that wide, and it's actually pretty easy to maneuver. So something that you guys are probably all familiar with is the tire and wheel setup on the Raptor. So no matter what configuration you get, you're always gonna get 17-inch wheels, and then you're always gonna get 35s for the tire setup. They're really wide, they're 315 millimeter for the width on them. Now, the one thing I would say about the specific rims that you pick out, this one obviously has the upgraded beadlocks. Now, if you are gonna keep the stock setup, then I would recommend getting these. They just look a little bit better, and obviously you have the added functionality, but if you are going to get aftermarket wheels and tires, obviously get the base model one so that you don't spend an extra 1700 bucks for no reason. And the next thing to mention with the front end is, if you guys remember, mine is a 2020, and for the 19s and the 20s, they changed the suspension, and the front end does sit higher on a 19 or a 20 compared to a 17 or an 18. So just from like an aesthetic standpoint, it looks a whole lot better, and I'll talk a little bit more on the suspension once we get to the rear, but just kind of like understand that if you get a 19 or a 20, it's going to sit a little bit higher compared to like a 17 or an 18. Now here is the key fob for my Raptor. They have changed this key fob through the production run of the Raptor. They had the different key fob for the 17s, for example, but this is the newest iteration on the key fob. It says Raptor on the back of it. And then in terms of functions on it, you have your lock at the top, you got the unlock in the middle, remote start, and then this is what drops down the tailgate. So if you guys want to hear what the exhaust sounds like, and by the way, this is an aftermarket exhaust made by Corsa. I will get you some revving clips later in the video, but this is louder than what a stock exhaust is. Just understand that on the exhaust setup. Now the next thing is pretty neat is actually the tailgate drop down. Now I didn't think that I was going to use that much, but I actually have ended up using it a lot more than I thought. It's just really nice and convenient. I know it is not a necessity at all, but it's still pretty nice to be able to have that. The next thing is, a lot of people have mentioned, hey, why doesn't this have a bed liner? Now, a bed liner with the Raptors from the factory is almost 500 bucks, and the warranty on it is just with the basic warranty, whereas I can get a bed liner aftermarket done for less money, about $300 to $400, and then I can get a better warranty as well. A lot of them come with lifetime warranties, so I'm gonna get that done eventually. Just haven't gotten it done yet, but that's why I wouldn't recommend getting a bed liner from the factory. Now, the LED bed lights, these have come in handy at nighttime. The most handy thing in the back has actually been this little step. So I didn't think I was gonna use this because I'm 22 years old and I can jump, but this little step, I know it's in all the Fords pretty much, but it's super handy. I absolutely love it, and I've actually used it way more often than I thought I would. The last thing I want to talk about before we get into the suspension is with the logo on the tailgate. So you can get the like little Ford oval, and then it'll say Raptor on the side. I think it just looks absolutely horrible, and I'd recommend getting this just from an aesthetic standpoint. But the one thing to understand, and I've talked to other Raptor owners that have had this issue as well, is it doesn't really like stick on super well. So I don't know if you guys can kind of see, but it's just like very light, slightly coming off. And so just kind of like understand that with the logo on the tailgate. If you do get this, it is going to look better, but it obviously does have chance of kind of like very slightly coming off. And it's not horrible or anything like that, but it's just annoying from like a viewpoint. Okay, now let's get into the suspension. So obviously with the 19s and the 20s, they changed the color of the shocks to orange, and they added the live valve system, which is awesome on the off-road. The one thing that I will mention though is the 19s and the 20s don't drive as smooth on-road compared to a 17 or an 18. So if you are going to mainly be driving the Raptor on-road, then a 17 or an 18 is going to drive a little bit smoother. But if you are going to be taking this off-road, this new setup is definitely worth it, and it does so much better on the off-road. I'm going to include links to the videos that I have taken the Raptor off-road and jumped it and all that, so you guys can see that. But just trust me, this setup is great for the off-road. Out here in the back, the one complaint that I have about the door panel here in the back is just that they don't use nicer materials. Like, they have a little carbon fiber insert, which looks cool, but then the rest of it is just kind of cheap. And then with the rest of the back seats, overall I've had a pretty good experience with the back seats, just with like the usability on them, really easy to pick them up, and then obviously load stuff down here. I mean, you guys can see I have stuff stored under the seats, and the heated seats, trust me, they work great whenever you have people back here. And then the little charging areas, those also work great. Cup holders are good. Legroom is great. I would recommend getting the Super Crew over the Super Cab, just because it's so much more practical here in the back. And I'm gonna talk a little bit more about the Recaro seats once we get up to the front, but in terms of like holding up with how they look, they still look great. Now with the keyless entry here in the front, it is a little bit finicky sometimes, and this isn't just like a Ford thing. It happens on all sorts of vehicles. My Rebel had the same thing. And so again, just kind of understand that sometimes it's just not gonna be great, but that is a thing. And yes, I got the truck detailed, but the dog kind of already slobbered here, and so I'm gonna have to like clean it up again. But yeah, at least I tried to like have the truck clean for like 2 seconds. I don't really have any complaints about this area, but one thing that is neat is that the Raptor does come with power folding mirrors, which is a nice little function, and I love the carbon fiber. Definitely recommend it as an option. Now, with the Recaro seats here at the front, the one thing that I will say is I love the looks on the seats. And for me, again, being 22 years old, these are great from like an aesthetic standpoint, and then also from a comfort standpoint for me. But the one thing I will say is the traditional black seats you can get with the Raptor, just because those are full leather and they don't have the Alcantara inserts, they do soften up over time. These, however, don't soften up over time nearly as much. It pretty much always stays firm, which I personally like, but I can't imagine that some people would definitely like kind of like the softer seating. So if you do want like a softer seat, then I would definitely recommend that. And obviously those will be easier to clean than blue. And the one thing that I also have loved about the Raptor is the rubber floor mats. They're great at just like keeping dirt on them and trapping things, all that kind of stuff. This thing here has been kind of annoying because it's really hard to keep clean, but I mean, that's kind of expected. And other than that, all the controls here, they're really easy to use, and I love the placement on them with the Raptor. Like, the light controls, always easy to use. These lights for the side mirrors, always easy to use as well. And yeah. Now, like I said, I'm not gonna go over every single feature on the Raptor. I'm just gonna kind of mention the things that I've noticed from owning one, and then this will hopefully help determine if you should buy one or not before we get into the driving portion. So here with the steering wheel, overall, I've loved the steering wheel. I love how they have like the smooth leather all around it, just really comfortable to grab, just with how it's shaped and everything, and the feel of it, it's always great. And one thing to mention, the magnesium paddles, they feel really nice and premium. I mean, you have that nice metallic sound and everything, but they do get really hot in the sun, and then in the winter time they do get really cold, so just take that into account. The one thing I do want to mention, the adaptive cruise control system works really great. That's something that I've loved on the Raptor, so I would recommend getting that, especially if you commute a lot on the highway. I use it all the time. The steering modes, you can actually feel a difference between the steering modes, which is really cool. In terms of the drive modes, I have gone controversy over this, so I am going to mention it. But the one thing that I have noticed is with the drive modes, I'm in the normal mode most of the time. In terms of the other drive modes, I haven't used them as much. Okay, of course, it like shifts through instantly. So the deep snow and sand, I haven't used that much. The Baja, I haven't used it that much actually as well, even though I've off-roaded a ton. Rock crawl, I have used that particular mode. And then in terms of the other drive modes, okay, just let me go into different stuff. Jeez, Raptor. Okay, the slippery, again, I haven't really used that all that much, and then I don't really tow with the Raptor because it sucks at towing. The sport mode, though, I have loved the sport mode. Now, this is where there's gonna be a little bit of controversy, and it's because I've off-roaded with the sport mode over the Baja mode. Now, the reason that I've done it is I found that if you do the sport mode, so I'm not in the sport mode right now, but if you do the sport mode and you turn the traction control all the way off, so I have to hold the button down for about 10 seconds, and you'll know that it's off because it'll say advanced track off. When I've done that in the sport mode in four-wheel drive, it just drives really good on the off-road because the shifts are a little bit quicker than Baja, I've noticed. It holds the RPMs at the perfect amount. Baja seems to hold the RPMs way too high up in the rev range to be very good on the off-road, whereas the sport mode seems to be at the perfect place. And so I know it's a little bit weird, but that's kind of what I've found personally driving my Raptor. I know there's gonna be people with Raptors that have different opinions, and they're gonna think that they're right, and I'm gonna think that I'm right, and there's all that kind of argument about it. I've gotten a lot of crap for it, but that's what I found. Normal mode is great for like almost 99% of the driving you'll be doing, and sport mode, four-wheel drive, traction control off, I have found just does so good on the off-road, and I like that more than Baja, to be honest. Like, that mode, I will pick over Baja just because the shift times feel just a little bit quicker in sport compared to Baja. The next little thing that's been pretty cool is the camera system. So the Raptor does have the 360 camera system. The only thing that would be a little bit nicer on this camera system is if you could use it at higher speeds. It kind of caps you out at pretty low speeds to use, like, the front camera, for example, which, I mean, the Raptor is supposed to be, like, a high-speed Baja truck, and so it'd be nice to be able to use the front camera just in case when you are driving on the off-road at really high speeds. And other than that, the infotainment system, response time on it is pretty decent. I would recommend getting a Raptor that's a 2020 if the infotainment system is important to you, because they updated it in 2020 to be a little bit more responsive with the touch time and all that. And yeah, now here in this whole area, I actually really like the aesthetic look of everything here. And again, one more recommendation, get the carbon fiber. Even if you get the black interior, I do recommend the carbon fiber, because just like all the little carbon fiber touches definitely liven up the interior, make it look a little bit sportier. The one thing that I will mention is I wish that there was like a place to hold my phone, just like somewhere here. The new Rams, you have that like phone holder right at the front, whereas you pretty much have to use a cup holder or down there to hold your phone, and it's not really that accessible, so that would be nice. Center console is nice, massive, and it's kind of like nice just to like touch the Alcantara there on the side. Just saying. I love the carbon fiber trim there as well. It's cool for my passengers to be able to see. The glove box has been great on top of that, and I've loved the blue stitching all throughout that comes with this Recaro package. Definitely another nice little feature that I've liked with the Raptor so far. Up top, I've really liked the auxiliary switches, just because it makes you feel like you're doing something substantial. You're like a pilot and you're like boom. And so yeah, I need to like get these switches hooked up to stuff, do some cool stuff with my truck, but that's kind of a cool thing. Now with the sunroof, I haven't noticed any difference in terms of drivability with a truck with the sunroof and a truck without the sunroof. So if you want a sunroof, get it. If you don't want it, don't get it. Pretty straightforward on that. You can jump the truck with the sunroof. Again, link in the description below to me to jumping the truck. No issues with the sunroof. Everything functions correctly. I mean, you guys can see right here opening up the shade. Still works. Have had no leaks, no issues or anything like that. So again, if you want the sunroof, get the sunroof. Now let's quickly get into pricing on Raptors, both new and used. So if you get a brand new Raptor, depending on how spec'd out you go with the Raptor, the MSRP is anywhere from like literally the mid 50s all the way up to the mid 70s. Like this truck that I built out here was almost $75,000 for the sticker price. Now the used market in terms of pricing, again, it depends on the specification on the truck. If you get like a super cab base model used, obviously that's gonna be a lot less money than if you get this truck used. And pricing on the used market seems to be anywhere from like the high 40s all the way up to $70,000 still for some used trucks if it's like a really low mileage 2020, for example. If you guys are wondering, I'm already at 8,600 miles and I got this truck back in November, so I've put quite a few miles on it, and so I have had time for stuff to break if it is going to break on the truck. But yeah, now let's get into the drive portion. where I'm going to mention kind of like my final thoughts on a Raptor and if you should buy a used Raptor. Going to start this video like we should start, or not this video. Oh, I hope you guys heard that little backfire, but we're going to start this drive portion with an acceleration because that's super important. Oh, it's still like that exhaust from Corsa, just it transforms this, and I'm pretty sure I'm going to get the X pipes to make this even louder, but like it still sounds really good. And look at that, you guys get backfires with that exhaust. So super happy with that. And that's the first thing I actually want to talk about is just the sound that you get with the truck. There's so many complaints about this V6 from like an ownership perspective. I've loved the sound. I've said this a million times. I love the turbo sound along with the exhaust note. No, it's not a big V8, but it still sounds really good in my opinion. And the other thing that I love about this engine and this whole truck setup is, yes, the first gen Raptor has the 6.2, but this engine is lighter, and on top of that, the whole truck is lighter. And so what you get from like a performance standpoint is you get a truck that's lighter, that has more power, that has more torque, and so it's just a better performing vehicle all around compared to the first gen Raptor. And I think that's super important. Actually, you know what? I'll leave the window open for you guys so you guys can get some exhaust if you're kind of falling asleep during the video. But I think that's super important. This truck performs significantly better compared to a first gen Raptor. And it's just from like all perspectives. The ride quality is better. I've driven plenty of first gens to know that. And I feel like the overall build quality on the truck is actually better. Like there's a lot less rattling and all that kind of stuff. There is still some. It is a Ford. You gotta remember that. But it's significantly better. Now, while we're waiting here for just a second, or actually I'll just skip ahead so you guys can get another fat pull. Well, here we go. Fat pull numero dos. And we'll see if we can get another backfire here. It was a baby one. Now, the biggest thing that I see when I have people ask me, should you buy a used Raptor, is the fact that people are worried about like the condition of a Raptor. And I feel like I'm the perfect person to talk about this because I think more than the average Raptor owner, I take mine off-road like a substantial amount. Most people that I've talked to that own Raptors, they might go for like a weekend trip every so often, whereas I have put several thousand miles on this Raptor on the off-road. I've jumped it a ton of times. And so if a Raptor is like used, it's my Raptor, like 100%, like my Raptor has been used to do Raptor stuff. And from a reliability standpoint, I haven't had any issues with the suspension. I haven't had any issues with the performance of the truck. Nothing from like a, I guess like negative reliability standpoint that's been associated with jumping the truck. Like you'd expect that the truck would be misaligned on the front end because I've taken it off road a bunch and I've jumped it a bunch. No issues with the alignment, no issues with the shocks. Now you guys do remember I did have that issue with the brakes on the truck, and you know that is definitely up for debate with what was actually wrong with the truck. What I think happened is I think the truck just had a bad brake from the start. I don't, and that was kind of funny, a bad brake, but anyways, I think that there was something wrong with the brake in the back from the start. I don't think that it was because of off-roading it. I don't think it was because of something I did to the truck. I think the truck just had a fault from the factory. But anything else, and there is another thing that happened with the truck, which that's a whole nother video, but anything else with the truck, it hasn't been associated with that. So what I have to say, and I think this is what I'm going to cap this video off with, is I think that it's completely okay to buy a used Raptor. I don't think that you should be worried about the stuff that's happened to the Raptor. Now, yes, get a pre-purchase inspection, but that stands for any used vehicle. But if you're in like a mindset where you're like, I can't buy a used Raptor because the dude before it jumped it, or the dude before me off-roaded it, all that kind of stuff, or I should say gal as well, but
I wouldn't be worried about that. I'd get a pre-purchase inspection, and if everything checks out, then save some money from buying a new truck, because my spec'd out truck, $75,000, that's a lot of money. And if you can afford a used one, I would definitely go that route, and I wouldn't worry about as much as what you think you should, if that makes sense. So yeah, the Raptor's a great truck to go for. If a used one is what fits in your budget, I would not like throw the truck out as an option. I would definitely look into that, because it's a great truck. And if you love off-roading, you will definitely love this truck. That is gonna sum things up for our video today on the Raptor and whether or not you should buy a used Raptor. But as always, if you're stopping in for the first time, please subscribe, comment down below what you think, and then I will see all of you in the next video.